Hello everyone, and welcome to this first video lecture on kinematics. In this lecture, I will introduce the concepts of coordinates and constraints. Let me start off by introducing the concept of coordinates. Let us consider first a point mass. Point mass, which is free to move in the two-dimensional plane. So here I will draw the point mass, and maybe it moves along this trajectory, for instance. Now, we can think about how do we describe the motion of this point mass. What we will use for it is a so-called coordinate frame. And I will use a Cartesian coordinate frame with an x and a y-axis like this. This is the x-axis and this is the y-axis. And for describing the motion, we will identify the x and the y coordinates of this point mass as a function of time. Okay, let me assemble these x and y coordinates in the vector q, which may vary in time and contains the x and y location of the point mass. So x and y in this sense are referred to as coordinates, in the sense that they are measures along the axes. Okay, next up, consider a rigid body. A rigid body, which has actual dimensions. Okay, so this point mass is in fact a particle with zero dimensions, but now we consider a rigid body. And this rigid body can be thought of as an assembly of infinitely many point masses. Okay, but that would come with infinitely many coordinates. So therefore, that's not very practical. We do it differently. Again, we introduce a Cartesian coordinate frame, x and y. Okay, but for uniquely describing the motion of this rigid body, we will identify one point on the rigid body of which we will use the x and y coordinates. So x as a function of time, y as a function of time. And then attached to this point, we will add a local coordinate frame. I will sometimes call this frame the floating frame. And to uniquely describe the motion, we not only use the position, but we also use the orientation of this body. And this orientation is uniquely described by the following angle that I will call theta, which might also change in time if the body is rotating. And this angle theta is defined in this case in between the x-axis of the global body, sometimes a global frame, sometimes denoted by O, and the local frame. Okay, so in this case, we expand the vector q to contain x, y, and theta. Okay, now the vector q is called the vector of generalized coordinates. Let me write that down. Q are the generalized coordinates. And why do we call these coordinates generalized? Well, as we consider systems that may contain not only point masses, but also rigid bodies, and we also need these parameters theta that uniquely define the orientation. And these angles are not coordinates in the sense that they are measures along an axis. Okay, but they are still useful parameters, and therefore we call them generalized coordinates. Now, if you have a multi-body system consisting of multiple point masses and multiple rigid bodies, it's important to establish the total number of generalized coordinates that you are going to need in your problem. For that, I will define nq as the number of generalized coordinates. And nq can be computed as 2 times the number of point masses, where np is the number of point masses, because each point mass has an x and a y coordinate. plus 3 times the number of bodies, of rigid bodies, because each rigid body has an x, y, and a theta. Okay, so that would define then the total number of generalized coordinates in your problem. Okay, now the generalized coordinates Q, they define position and orientation, but we are interested in dynamics, so that is motion. How are these coordinates changing over time? And for that, we need to introduce the concept of velocity. Velocity. And I will denote that by Q dot, which are in fact the generalized velocities. And these are the time derivatives of Q. Q differentiated with respect to time. Okay, so I use this over dot to denote differentiation with respect to time. And for a rigid body, it would be x dot, y dot, and theta dot. Okay, what we see in this vector is that x dot and y dot, they are linear velocities. Linear velocity. These components are sometimes denoted by the letter v, but we also have theta dot, which is an angular velocity in radians per second, and sometimes we use the letter omega for it. Now we can differentiate once more. We also need expressions for the accelerations, so acceleration is also an important concept, and that will be denoted by a double over dot, which is the second derivative of Q with respect to time. Okay, and that for one rigid body would consist of x double dot, y double dot, and theta double dot. Oh, theta double dot. Okay, and like with the velocities, we have linear accelerations. Accelerations. You might know them by the letter A, but we also have angular acceleration. Angular acceleration. And that is sometimes denoted by the Greek letter alpha. Okay, so now we know what we mean in this lecture when I use the term coordinates, also what makes them generalized, and how velocity and acceleration are related to these generalized coordinates. Now, next up, I would like you to consider a system where we have multiple bodies and point masses that are linked together. And this brings me to the concept of constraints. So suppose this is one body that is maybe connected to the fixed world over here. Okay, but it can be connected to another body. Maybe there's a hinge here. Okay, so there's different multiple bodies that are connected to each other or to the fixed world in these points. And these points I will call interface points. Interface points. Now, the fact that they are connected in these interface points to each other or to the fixed world makes that the total system, that these bodies are not free to move anymore. And as a consequence, there will be relations in between the coordinates. Now, at each interface point, there is a physical constraint that limits the motion of this body. And what we will see is that from a mathematical point of view, we can set up a set of what we will call constraint equations. Constraint equations. These equations I will denote by capital C, and they are expressed in terms of the generalized coordinates, and we can write them such that they are equal to zero. There are also more complicated constraint equations that, for instance, also depend on velocity, but these we will not encounter during this course. So C, in fact, is a vector of equations in terms of the coordinates that describe somehow how the motion of the body is limited, is constrained at these interface points. So if how can we express this? This is a vector, and here we have the first constraint equation, which is a function of q, and this goes all the way to nc as a function of q, where I introduce nc as the number of constraint equations. And these are all zero. Oh, this zero disappeared, like this. Okay, now I think that there's a very important relation between the number of degrees of freedom. Maybe I should write that down. Degrees of freedom that a system has, and the number of constraint equations. Let n dof be the number of degrees of freedom. It is equal to nq, which is the total number of generalized coordinates we need to uniquely describe the motion, minus the number of constraint equations. I have to add here maybe independent constraint equations. So this means that for each constraint equation, for each independent constraint equation that we add, the number of degrees of freedom goes down. This basically means, this emphasizes that the motion of the system can be described with less than nq coordinates. We only need a few coordinates, and then the rest should follow somehow from the constraints that are imposed. So this means that these constraint equations, that they can be manipulated such, at least in theory, let me write it down. So we have these constraint equations that are NC equations in terms of Q, and we should be able to rewrite them such that we can split the generalized coordinates Q in a set of dependent coordinates and independent coordinates. Okay, and what do I mean with that? Well, for each constraint equation that we have, there will be one dependent coordinate, and the number of independent coordinates equals the number of degrees of freedom. So it should be done in such a way that the dependent coordinates QD are expressed in terms of only a few other coordinates. So for instance, that somehow the x and y position are related to theta. This is, for instance, the case when we have a hitch. Okay, so this is the idea that depending on the nature of the constraint equations C, we are able to express all coordinates in terms of only a few. Now, what we will see is that we will also need relations between the dependent and independent velocities and accelerations. And in the most general case, we will see that the dependent velocities are a function of both the independent position as well as the independent velocities, and that the dependent accelerations are in general a function of both the independent coordinates, the independent velocities, and the independent accelerations. Maybe for some simple example, these relations are very straightforward, but there are more complicated examples where the acceleration really depends on independent position, velocity, and acceleration. Okay, I think with this I have introduced the concepts of coordinates and constraints. This concludes this video lecture, and in the next video I will give you some examples to give you a little bit of a feeling for how to deal with the set of coordinates and constraints. Thank you for watching.